didn't happen. How's it possible? God is not going back on his word. So how could he consider that his heir is going to be Eliezer, the head of his household, and not his own biological child? So what we had once said, that the location where Eliezer is identified as Damascus Eliezer, Damascus. In Hebrew, the word Damascus means Damascus. Came from Damascus. The Torah only shares with us information which has relevance to the narrative, and what has relevance to us, give us an understanding of many things. Does it really make a difference if Eliezer came from Damascus, or we came from Aleppo, or we came from Alexandria, Egypt? It's all irrelevant. The Gemara tells us, Damascus Eliezer, it's an acronym, Dole Mashkim Toros Sharabo. He drew from the wellsprings of his teacher, of his master of Torah. Whatever God had transmitted to Avram in regard to Torah, this was communicated to Eliezer. When we speak about Kol Amalami Torah Ben Chaveru Kili Yoldo, a person who teaches Torah to a fellow's child, it's as if he actually fathered that child. Because every aspect of the development and the meaningful impact and effect, which only comes through Torah, that comes through the teacher, the Rebbe. So we'd say, it's Kili Yoldo. So therefore, he said, who's going to be my heir? Damascus Eliezer. Because since he's Dola Mashke, since he's the one who draws from my wellsprings to disseminate Torah, he is my primary student. Nobody's ever developed spiritually as he has. Maybe that's how the promise will manifest itself. God says, your biological child. However, it was only possible if he was Avraham. Avram Elo Ben, Avram Yeshlo Ben. Avram has no son. That's what the Zodiac reads. Avraham Yeshlo Ben. Now what is the sign? Only after the hay was added, only then was he able to father the future patriarch of Klal Yisrael, of the Jewish people. Avraham who lives in Yisrael. Only after the hay was added. Now it's very interesting. When the hay was added to Avram's name, at the same time he was circumcised. He had the bris milah. He and his household had to have the bris milah. We mentioned in the name of the Archaim HaKadosh, in the portion of Tazria, that when God created Adam, he had no foreskin. He created without a foreskin. After he had eaten of the fruit of the Eitz HaDaas, the tree of knowledge, which was Tov V'ra, the Ra, what is evil? Evil is a distortion of truth. If a person will truly recognize evil to be evil, you recognize an inferno. Are you going to put your hand in the inferno and self-destruct and have your hand incinerated? Of course not. It's only because you see evil as good. Everything is a distortion. That's what it is. So what? It's a covering. It covers. So when he ate of the tree of knowledge, the foreskin grew. It covered the reproductive organ. It's a covering. Klal Yisrael were given the mitzvah of milah, which is removal of that covering. That itself, factually, we all descend from Adam. Factually, when Hashem says, the inclination of man is evil from the moment he's cast from his mother's womb, this applies to every human being. Every human being is a descendant of Adam. Adam ingesting that fruit, every human being is tainted with that. But the question is to what degree? What degree are we tainted? Klal Yisrael were given the mitzvah of milah, of circumcision, by removing that foreskin, it affects and gives us the ability to take control. To take control, to have full control over our choices, to be able to achieve as if we never had a foreskin. Avraham, numerically, is Ramach, 248. So Chazal say, the Medrash tells us, until he was circumcised, he did not have control over five of his parts of his body. His two eyes, his two ears, and his reproductive organ. Once he was circumcised, now he had full control over Ramach, every part of his body. He had full control. So that itself minimized the effect of that evil that was intermingled and ingested by Odom when with the circumcision, but the name change had to take place. The name change. There had to be a profound internal change within Odom, within Avram. What brought about that change? The hay. Now what was the hay? So the Medrash says, Hashem says to Avram, as I created all existence with the spirituality of the hay, for you to be able to father a child, which will be the future of existence, which your grandchildren will stand at Sinai and see Nasim and Nishma and receive the Torah, you have to have that same effect, what was needed to bring that all existence, to bring about that change, that you should be able to father that kind of child, and you should be that person who's qualified to father that child, you have to have that same level of input, which encompasses all creation. That's what you need. So the hay, Avram, became a new creation. And as I mentioned, Neiman Maral, Behi Borom, when he created them, is the letters, if you conjugate the letters, it's Avram. It's the letters Avram. Avram was the beginning of a new creation. Now, why did he have to be the beginning of a new creation? Avram Avinu, even before he became circumcised, when he sent Eliezer to find a wife for Yitzchok, Eliezer asked Avram, maybe the woman who you're looking for, she may not want to return with me. So he said, he refers to Hashem as Elokei HaShemayim, who took me out of from my father's household. And then he refers to God as Elokei HaShemayim, Elokei Oretz. The God of heaven and the God of earth. Is he the God of heaven or is he the God of earth? Why does he initially refer to Hashem as God, as the God of heaven, and then the God of heaven and earth? Initially, when Avram came on the scene, God was an unknown entity in existence. He was only in Shemayim, but even more than the Shekhinah, the divine presence, ascended to heaven because they had no realms to earth. Man rejected him through their paganism. Avram, by disseminating monotheism, he brought the Shekhinah back to the terrestrial level. That's what Avram Avinu did through his interaction, refuting paganism. Now, Adam Arishon, Adam, when he was created, where was the Shekhinah? The divine presence was on the terrestrial level. And that was the primary location. Not with the angels. It's where man is, where man has choice. That's where God wants to be. To be associated with those who choose to be his children and merited to be his children. Who achieved that? Avram. So in essence, what is Avram? What was Avram's level of accomplishment? His level of accomplishment was Odom before he had sinned. Odom was disenfranchised. Atem Krim Odom. Avram assumed the status of Odom, of Adam. That status. Now you and your children, ultimately, you're the objective of creation. Bishul Yisroshnik Horatius. Bishul Toroshnik Horatius. So therefore he had to be circumcised. His profile, his physical profile, had to have the same profile as Adam. Adam had no foreskin. Avram has no foreskin. Yitzchok, when is he being fathered? Without a foreskin. How did Odom and existence come about? Through the hay. The spirituality that hay brought about existence. So Avram is a replication of Odom when nobody existed outside of Odom when Odom was created. Avram, nobody exists outside of Avram, although he exists within the world is not his world. That world is a different world. Therefore, the world has relevance to Shev Mitzvah Menoach. Seven Noahide laws. What are seven Noahide laws? Seven represents the material, physicality. Klal Yisrael is a spiritual people. And not that. It's interesting to note that Murray tells us, why did God choose the hay to create the world? Because it emphasizes the point that man has free choice. The legs of the hay are wide open. If man chooses to go into free fall, to go into the oblivion, that's his choice. But what happens if he wants to be true, he wants to repent? He can't come back from the same location that he exited. He has to come back through that small opening on the left side of the hay, which is next to the top, next to the horizontal line, which is called tshuva. Now, who has relevance to the tshuva? That it should be a full rehabilitation. Only Klal Yisrael, only the Jew. For the Jew to be fully rehabilitated, only the Jew has relevance to tshuva. Even though Ninveh did tshuva, that tshuva was only that God shouldn't destroy them. But to be spiritually rehabilitated to the point where it's not as if they never sinned, that only has relevance to the Jew. The Maral explains, the Maral of Prague, that when a non-Jew sins, the sin emanates from his essence. The Jew, when he sins, it's only incidental. Because it's only incidental, it's not terminal, but rather it's something which can be rehabilitated. So in terms of Ninveh, God will not destroy them, and they can continue doing good things. But whatever damage or destruction which came about on a personal level to them as a result of that sin, that remains. That cannot be changed. By Klal Yisrael said, the whole idea of the hay really only has relevance to Klal Yisrael. The hay, because the hay was created, Bereishis Bara Elokim, it was created for Yisrael, it was created for what? For the Torah. That only has relevance. Only has relevance to the Jew. This is Avraham holding Sitzim. Avram fathered Yitzchak. Only when he had the name change was he able to father that child. Thinking, the Midrash quotes a pasuk, Mishle, Gil Yogil Avi Tzadik. The father of the tzadik will rejoice from the word Gilo. The Yolit Chocham, and the one who fathers a wise one, Yismach, will he rejoice with him. Keneged Mi Amaru Shlomo, who is Shlomo referring to? That the father rejoicing when he has the tzadik and when he has the son who's the Chocham, that special son, the wise one. He rejoices. That's what we're about to Yitzchok. She be sure she know that Yitzchok. When Yitzchok was born, everyone was happy. Shemayim v'oretz, heaven and earth. When happy, they rejoiced. The sun and the moon. Kochav mazolus. The stars and the zodiac and the constellations. Why were they so happy? Because if Yitzchak wouldn't have been created, the word is, the world wouldn't have continued. If not for my covenant, which is the existence day and night, the extent of heaven and earth wouldn't have been put in place. I will establish my covenant with Yitzchak. Yitzchak was born naturally as part of a new existence. Avram was part of the old existence, and he was converted to be part of a new existence. But Yitzchak is what? Is the original of the what? He's the one truly, Adam Kodem Achet. He's Adam before, because he was never tainted with what Avram was tainted. So therefore, the Pasuk Yimel Bris Yom V'loy, although the Midrash is applying it to bris. My bris I will establish. What's in Bris Yom Vavoylo? The Mishnah tells us this refers to Torah. The bris, which has to be in effect day and night, and if it should cease for a moment, the world would revert back to pre-existence, this is the study of Torah. Now, why does the study of Torah have relevance to us? Only because we are that new creation.
We are the new world. We are the new world. We're not that old world. The old world was putrefied. The old world was damaged on a permanent level. They have no relevance to Torah. As a result of that, when Yitzchak was born, and he ultimately, because if he was qualified to father Yaakov, which is Klal Yisrael, which are the Shiftei Koh, the 12 tribes, therefore, all existence rejoiced. Because now, existence goes forward. If there wouldn't have been a Yitzchak, there wouldn't have been a Yaakov. Yitzchak was 40 years old when he took Rivka, Bas Besuel, Harami, Yipavna Roma. When he took Rivka, the daughter of Besuel, Harami, the charlatan, from Padna Roma, Achos Lovan Harami, Lodisha, the sister of Lovan, also the Armenian, the Ramai, the charlatan, for a wife. So Rashi cites the Midrash. What do we have to identify who the father was? The father's community, a brother. So Rashi explains, based on the Midrash, v'chadayin lo nichtav she bas besuel. Already, it's been written earlier, if she's the daughter of besuel. Bachos Lovon, she's the sister of Lovon, Upadna Rom, and the community, El Lagit Shvocha, Shivcha, to tell us the praiseworthiness of Rivka, Shohesa Bas Rosho. She was the sister of a Rosho, Ba'achos Rosho, the sister of a Rosho, Umakoma Achi Resha, and a community with members who they were all evil. Lolivim Asim, she did not learn from their ways. Find that when Eliezer was sent to find a wife for his family, and he gave very precise, exact instructions, so he says, what will be if she won't want to come back? All kinds of questions. He says, Hashem will send his malach. It'll work out, but even more difficult. His family were idolaters. They were pagans. Haran went into the kiln. That was Lot's father. But the rest of them, Hashem says, leave your family. They have no capacity for spirituality whatsoever. So let's say Rivka's from his family. But how was he so sure that this would be the wife for Yitzchak, the future matriarch of Klal Yisrael, to be able to be the mother of Yaakov? How did he know this? And especially, the Torah is speaking about a praiseworthiness, a father, a community, a brother. Despite that, she didn't have Avraham Avinu know this. How do you know? And so assured. You'd say, maybe, you know, if there's a Yitzchak and Hashem, and he withstood the test of the Akedah, evidently, there must be a wife from his family. In terms of characteristic-wise, it has to be his family. To have the traits of the family. But if she's a pagan woman, it's a problem. And if God performed the miracle and allowed him to be put on and taken off, and this was the test, needs a wife. Evidently, there must be that woman. A woman who qualifies. It must be. So you'd say it's Avram's trust in Hashem. His belief and trust in Hashem, that's what it's based upon. And Eliezer asking the questions, either because he had the conflict of interest, because he had his own daughter, or he wasn't at the level of Avram. First, Eliezer wasn't at the Akedah. Eliezer, the Malach spoke to Avram, right, when he says, withdraw your hand from the land. And because you demonstrated your reverence for Hashem, you will be like the stars of the heaven. The earth, the land will be yours. He heard all this. So evidently, there's going to be a child. If there's a child, there has to be a matriarch. So because he was told that, he figured there's going to be. It has to be from his family.
She must be a tzadekas. But factually, after everything's said and done, the woman must really be something special. Not to be influenced by a father, not to be influenced by her community, not to be influenced by a brother. She's something special. Avram figured it out by himself. But how did he figure it? Based on his faith and his belief. However, Chazal tell us, right after the Akedah, Avram was informed through divine communication, through Ruach HaKodesh, that Rivka was born. Meaning, and that's why Yitzchak stayed for 3 years on Har Moriah. It was only after 3 years, it was until she was 3 years old, there wasn't a consideration to her as a wife, as Rashi brings, cites over here. So therefore, Avram, it wasn't only based on his faith and his belief, but he had a communication that the wife, the qualified woman to be the matriarch, is born, and you just have to wait now. 3 years, she's ready to be taken. This is something Eliezer didn't know. Eliezer is questioning, maybe, what, when, if. Hashem will send his angel. It's going to work out. How you so assured? Because Avram doesn't share everything with Eliezer. Yitzchak, maybe he was also informed. He probably shared it with him. Yitzchak only after 3 years. I mean, it's the timing was perfect. As Yitzchak was returning, what happened? Eliezer's coming with the camels, with Rivka. And immediately he takes her as his wife. So the moment he came back, immediately he assumed the position of patriarch. And Rivka became matriarch. As it says, he brought her into the tent of his mother, Sarah. Just as when his mother was alive, there were certain miracles that the candle always burned. There was always a cloud overhead. And there was a brocha in the dough when she would bake. And after Sarah made her pass away, it all ceased. The moment he brought Rivka as his wife into that tent, everything was restored. Everything started over again. So that was a confirmation that she was the qualified matriarch. But how did he know it? Because he knew. From that moment, 3 years, that's the time. That's when he assumes the role of patriarch. And when does he assume the role of patriarch? When he has a matriarch. And as a result of that, we find, at that moment, the Torah tells us that Avram Avinu passed away. In fact, Avram didn't pass away for another 33 years. So what does the Torah, for all intents and purposes, says Avram is no longer alive? He is alive. Yitzchak was alive when Yosef was sold into slavery. Yitzchak. That's Yitzchak. We're talking about Avram. Avram was alive. He was alive because he passed away when Yaakov and Esav were bar mitzvah. This is why he was cooking the lentil soup. Because Yitzchak was mourning. Right? So what is Torah saying? He was no longer alive. Until Yitzchak was married, who was the patriarch of Klal Yisrael? Avraham Avinu. He was the patriarch. Why was the patriarch? Because initially he had a matriarch. Until someone assumes the position of patriarch, he remains the patriarch. His life continuously is an input and provides and contributes to the future of Klal Yisrael. The moment the new patriarch takes over, but the new patriarch cannot be a patriarch to be the successor until he is a matriarch. So when was Avram no longer the patriarch? When Yitzchak became the patriarch, became the Av. When did he become the Av? When he was married. The Rivka maybe, when she became the matriarch. Therefore, for all intents and purposes, Avram no longer had relevance to the development of Klal Yisrael. Now Yitzchak assumes that position. Now he contributes. His decisions, his life, whatever he is, this now becomes Klal Yisrael, Yitzchak and Rivka Imenu. We find that the most, the matriarchs, they were barren. Sarah Imenu was Akora, was barren. Rivka was barren. Rachel was barren. And even Leah, initially, God opened a womb so she should be beloved to Yaakov. something unusual. Every one of the matriarchs should be barren. So the Medrash tells us, Hashem has a desire for the supplications of tzaddikim, person who does not have such a good record. And he's not beloved to Hashem. And he continually comes and knocks on his door. Hashem doesn't want to look at him. He just provides what he has, just stay away, stay out of my eye range. I don't want to look at you. But somebody who's beloved to Hashem, just to the contrary, he wants him to continuously come. If he wants him to knock on his door. So by denying him, he's continuously knocking on his door. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is misabed tfilosei shel tzadikim. He desires it, but it's more than that. But why does he desire it? Of course, it has to do with his ava, his love for them. But because he loves them, what happens when the person is in need? Like we find with Sari Meir. She did all kinds of things. She didn't leave a stone unturned, because she attributed her not being able to conceive that there's some kind of spiritual shortcoming within herself. So she did whatever she could to have the schus, the merit. So she made advances in her own spirituality. Each one of the avos and imos, when they prayed, they made changes in their lives to upgrade, continuously upgrade. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu Misaveh desires the tefillah of tzaddikim, because through the tefillah, you have to be worthy. So they made themselves, they made changes to advance themselves to be more worthy. That they should merit the midas harachmin, the attribute of mercy. They should merit the charm. But she's akor. That's Chazal. But the Rechaim HaKadosh points out something over here, which is not really with Chazal. It refers to her, she's the sister of Lavan. And the Torah tells us, Ayeta Yitzhak Lashem Ludoch Achishto Ki Akorim. Yitzhak prays opposite his wife, meaning on behalf of his wife, because she's barren. Vayyosel Lo Hashem Batarif Ki Ishto. So the Rechaim HaKadosh explains, we find there's a juxtaposition. She's referred to as the sister of Lavan, and then the Torah says, and she is barren. What does that juxtaposition teach us? That the reason why she was barren is because she was the sister of Lavan. In last week's reading, we had read that after they asked her, do you want to go with this man? Don't you want to go? She says, I'm going. I'll go with Eliezer. I will be the husband of Yitzchak. So they gave her a blessing. At, Ti, Alfi, Rebovo, you should be into the tens of thousands, and your progeny should inherit the gates of their enemies. That's the bracha Lavan and his mother gave to Rivka. Now all of a sudden, it's his children. Immediately. So what are people saying? And these children developed to be the most special family in the world, in the history of existence. They said, you know where that blessing emanates from? From that bad guy, from that evil source. Lavan. Hashem says, under no circumstances. The bracha of an evil person has no value whatsoever. No value. But even if she naturally conceives, what are people going to say? Mistakenly, they can say, you see, an evil person has value. So God causes her to be barren. That there should not be a consideration that the blessing has any value. It's a miracle. She's married for 20 years. She's barren. Miraculously, after 20 years, miracle happens, she conceives. But it was the blessing of love on it. Should have happened immediately. The answer is, the blessing of an evil person has no value. So here, the akor is not because HaKadosh Baruch Hu Misaveh desires the tefillah of tzaddikim, but rather it's to negate and dispel any consideration that an evil person has any value. Now it's interesting. You know, Shlomo Melech tells us initially in Proverbs, Shem Rishon Yirkav, the name of the evil should rot. It should rot. When something rots, there's not even a trace left. Of course, evil represents something which is contrary to Kedusha, to holiness. If in any way, Klal Yisrael is the Am Hashem, even to be identified to any degree with that, there's always the Shem Hashem is not Nirkav. The name of the evil is eternal Chas V'Shalom. Especially Klal Yisrael, the Am Hashem,
with eternal people. Eternally, Lavan is attached to our existence. We're synonymous. We have no relevance to that. Severed the connection. We find that Balak had commissioned Bilam to curse the Jews. He says, what you bless is blessed, what you curse is cursed. So, the Rechaim HaKadosh over there in the portion of Balak cites the Medrash that Bilam, besides being a prophet to a certain degree and a sorcerer, but he was also an astrologer. So he knew it when he would read the stars. So Balak became a king. He went to, he says, Balak, I want to give you a blessing, you're going to be a king. And the whole thing was deception. He only knew he was become the king because he saw in the stars that he was become the king. So when Balak became the king and assumed the mantle of royalty, he immediately attributed to Bilam's bracha. And this way everything, that's how he ingratiated himself, endeared himself to everybody. This man must be a special man, his blessing's phenomenal. But the whole thing was deception. That's what it was. And he says over there, his words, that Birchas Bilam, the blessing of Bilam is no better, has no greater value than Birchas Chamor, than the blessing of a donkey. And the donkey goes hee-haw, and somehow it sounds like a blessing. That's exactly what it's worth. It's not worth more than that. But Bilam, he tried to mislead people, they should think. Because anything that's evil has no relevance to bracha. Love one has no relevance to bracha. So if it would come out naturally, she would have children, and there'd be a Klal Yisrael, what does the world know? Bilam, he's somebody special. God allowed that his bracha should bring about his own I'm a nivchar, goy kodosh, chas v'sholom, akorei. 20 years, she's barren. And only then did she conceive. The pasuk uses an unusual term. It doesn't say, v'yispalo yitzot l'ashem. Prayed. Vayetar. What is the expression? It means tefillah, it means prayer, supplication. So Rashi explains, Hirbo v'hifse b'tefillah. He abundantly and he urged through his tefillah. It's a more powerful expression of prayer. Okay? The Gemara tells us that Vayetar comes from the word atar. A pitchfork. Take something, you turn it from, you turn it upside down. The power of this prayer was so powerful, it was able to overturn the Midas Adin into Midas Arachmin. From the attribute of justice to the attribute of mercy. That's Vayetar. Okay? But then the pasuk continues. Vayesa lo Hashem batar Rivka ishto. And Hashem responded, and Rivka became pregnant. Rivka's wife became pregnant. But Vayeoser is the same word as Vayetar. Vayetar, from Yitzhak's vantage point, we understand, he has to use a powerful expression of tefillah to make the difference. Because ordinary supplication is not going to make it happen. But Hashem, Vayeoselo, what does it mean? God answered him. Nispatzem, nispayis, nispatolo. So you have to put, you can say, because he was affected. Hashem allowed himself to be affected, meaning to decide to overturn it. Because of the intense, overwhelming prayer of Yitzhak. So I was thinking, we find, the Midrash tells us that the month of Tishrei is referred to as Chodesh HaShvi'i. Why is it known as Chodesh HaShvi'i, the seventh month? Because it comes from the word Shmur, from the oath. It's the month of the oath. God took an oath to Avram Avinu about something very specific. Avram Avinu, the most difficult of the tests, was the Akedah. And he succeeds. So after he succeeds, Avram says to Hashem, says to God, initially you told me my son is going to be like the stars in the heaven, the future of the world. Then you tell me
as you bring them up as a burnt offering. God, you know that I wanted to ask the question. I suppressed that desire and I did not ask the question. So just as I suppressed myself and did not ask the question, when Midas Adin, when the attribute of justice comes out against Klal Yisrael, I want the Midas HaRachmim to suppress and subdue the Midas Adin. I want you to take an oath. Hashem took the oath. That when the Midas Adin will rear its head, Chas V'Shalom, the Midas HaRachmim, the attribute of mercy, will suppress the Midas Adin. We find Chil Hashem is a very serious Jew has to live his life. God's name is being desecrated. Here, God creates the world, L'chodi Barosiv, for his own glory. L'chodi Barosiv. And what is that? For the sake of, that glory could only come through the Torah and only through Klal Yisrael. Klal Yisrael identify with love in Chas V'Shalom. That's what happens under those circumstances. It's Chil Hashem to attribute God's people to that evil man. God forbid. She will be an Akara. So when we say Midas HaDin, it means the attribute of Din, just as we will not tolerate it. We will not tolerate that association under any circumstance. Maybe even after 20 years. Even after 20 years. You never know, people would say, people say many things. I mean, Yitzchok looked exactly like his father. Avraham Hulid is Yitzchok. You don't think people still, the scoffers of generations still say, you never know. But why did it happen then? You never know. Chas V'Shalom, people would say, love him. It was his blessing which caused it to happen. You never know. So Midas HaDin is still in place. But because Yitzchok used such a powerful expression of tefillah, of supplication, the Yosalo, Hashem suppressed that position and negated it. And because of that, therefore, she conceived. That's why the Torah uses that same expression, V'yoselo. He agreed to be impacted because of that. Something very interesting. The Torah tells us that when a child's about to conceive, an angel takes the droplet of semen before Hashem, and God pronounces every aspect of that child's future. Wise, foolish, powerful, weak, healthy, infirm. Every aspect of the child's life. But tzaddik and rosho, evil and righteous, that pronouncement was not made. Why? Because hakol b'dei shemayim chutz miyushamayim. Everything's predestined to yushamayim. Okay? Why? Because the person has free choice. Yet we find over here, the Torah says, the children were being rumbling in our womb. There was agitation. So Chazal tell us that when Rivka would pass by a temple of idolatry, Esav would bolt to go to the temple of idolatry. And when she would pass by the yeshiva of Shem and Eber, which was holiness, Yaakov would bolt. This is pre. So here we see that this is also pre. This is preordained. Esav is evil, and Yaakov is what is holy and pure. What happened to Yaakov and Yishmael puts me Yerushalayim? Everything's predestined except one's spiritual fate. That's free choice. Now, Rambam in the Laws of Deos explains that in terms of predilections and characteristics and inclinations, you find many types of people. You have a person who has a stoic personality. You find a person who's pompous. A person is naturally humble. A person is naturally self-centered. A person has insatiable need for material. Another person has no interest in material. Now, why does God provide different types of profiles for different kinds of people? The answer is that because there are different contexts of choice, everybody has this tailor-made script that he has to live within that script. And if he succeeds within that script to make correct choices, then he succeeded. But you have to have all the elements in place for him to succeed in the choice. Therefore, people have different personalities. People have different inclinations. Esav, there's no question. You'd say a person who has insatiable need for material, he has to fight his demons in a very serious way. Another person naturally has no interest. He has an easier time in spirituality. Because he doesn't have to, it's not pushing a boulder up a mountain. The other person is pushing more than a boulder up a mountain. The choice is much more difficult. But if you succeed, the success is much greater. For the other person, the success is not such a great success, although he doesn't need more than that, because that's all that he needs. That Esav bolted, there's no question. He had something which drew him to evil, to paganism. But it doesn't mean to say he didn't have free choice. I mean, if Esav would have chosen to be Yaakov, he would have been greater than Yaakov. And he had the ability to be Yaakov. He had that ability. He chose to be Esav. To be Sonei LeYaakov. Yaakov naturally had relevance to holiness, to godliness. And that was indicated. But he maximized on it. Yaakov was Ishtam Yoshev Omen. He dedicated his whole life only to his spirituality, to the point where he's even able to defeat an angel in battle. And as a result of that, he became Yisrael. There's an interesting, obvious question, which always bothered me. Yisrael always connotes the spiritual classification of Yaakov. Yisrael, we are known as B'nai Yisrael, children of Israel. This was the name given to him by God after he had defeated the angel. Despite the difficulty with Laban and Esav, despite the angel, who he could have been killed, he lorded over them. You lorded over man, God and man, and you succeeded. You were victorious. That's Yisrael. It's confirmation. But whenever God identifies himself, he says, I am Elokei Avraham, I am Elokei Yitzchak, I am Elokei Yaakov. I'm talking about himself, you say, I am Elokei Yisrael. And so is Elokei Yaakov. And we on Shabbos, when we say the Amidah, we say, Zeri Yaakov Eshashem Bom Bechorim. The seed of Jacob, of Yaakov. Why not the seed of Yisrael? Why is it always Yaakov? So I think the way it should be understood, Yaakov didn't start as Yisrael. He only became Yisrael because he made special choices. And those choices are attributed to himself. So how do we appreciate who Yaakov truly was? He says, okay, so because Yisrael is the more advanced. He was endowed with that. No, he wasn't endowed with that. He was endowed with Yaakov. Yaakov may have a strong inclination for spirituality. But to bring it to Yisrael level, that's his own initiative. Fully attributed to him. So therefore, Hashem says, why am I like Elokei Yaakov? Because when he was the lesser level, he chose to be more than Yaakov. Therefore, God identifies himself as Elokei Yaakov, not as Elokei Yisrael for that reason. This is the understanding. So, when we're speaking about the bolting to go to the temple of idolatry, or bolting to go to the yeshiva of Shem Ve'Eber, that's only inclination-wise. They're inclined. This is like predilection, it's characteristic, it's a trait within the person. But in terms of what we call Yetzer Ra, we speak about evil inclination, all that, then that only enters into the child after he's born. That is only, that's already, that's something else you have to contend with. She was in tremendous pain. And she said, it came from Mamazat Noki. Why did I create to become pregnant? And I may die from this, from the pain. The Rechaim HaKadosh points out, it wasn't a consideration she would die, because God gave her such a miracle, and ultimately she should die.
or the children should die.
So she went and sought out some clarification. So she went to Shem, who's a prophet. He should give her a reading. So he told her, the two nations in your womb, and they will go out, and one will be powerful, and ultimately one they cannot coexist. When one rises, the other one falls, and the other one falls, the other one rises, so on and so forth. Now, does she share this with her husband? But she shared this with Yitzhak. Yitzhak, we find, is not aware of this at all. And it's very interesting. The Torah tells us, which it's interesting, you study Shara Kedusha, the chapter on holiness, and you see Sasharim, there's a person who's totally, who weans himself from all physicality, and whatever he does is at a, in the material sector, it's at a minimal level. And it's purely for the sake of God, correct? And the Torah tells us that the reason why Yitzhak loved Esav Kitzayim Mefid, because he fed him. He was a hunter, and he would feed him food. He told him Yitzhak. Yitzhak of you. He told about Yitzhak, the patriarch. He was the Merkava. He was the location of the Shechinah. And he enjoyed a good piece of meat. Is that what we're talking about over here? What does it mean? Kitzayim Mefid, because he would provide him with food. What is it about? So they say many interpretations. We read later, there's no question that Yitzhak knew that Yaakov was much more special than Esau. One's a man of the field, a hunter, and the other person dedicated to spirituality. Yaakov Shtam Yoshev Olam. He's the man, he personifies Torah, holiness. But we have to have the Mekemach in Torah. How do you live just on Torah itself? You need material. So Yaakov has to somehow interrupt his Torah study to provide for himself. So what will he do? Esav, being such an expert hunter and being dominating the material, let him be the provider. Because Yitzchak didn't know that Esav was truly evil. He knew he wasn't spiritualized as Yaakov, but he definitely values that. So if he's valuable, we'll make a partnership. Yaakov will be the Yisachar, dedicated to Torah, and Esav will be the Zvulun. But how do you know? Just because he's a hunter, who said he'll be such a phenomenal provider? How do you know that what he provides will be sufficient for Yaakov? So I was thinking, maybe we're able to say Kitzayim Mefid. Why did he love Kitzayim Mefid? Because the way he provided for him the material, and he had a sense from eating of his trappings that he is the proper provider. See, he loved him not because he provided him with food, because he, that is a confirmation that he will be the appropriate Zvulun to support Yisachar, to support Yaakov. And this partnership ultimately will bring about Chal Yisrael. That was the Avon. And may Kemach in Torah. Tzvach Zvulun B'tzei Sechor. Moshe Rabbeinu says, Zvulun, you should rejoice when you go out to the high seas, Yisachar B'olecho. Because if not for you, Yisachar can't study in the tent of Torah. So you're a direct cause. That's why he loved him. Because may Kemach in Torah. That's the tzayid b'fiu. The way he provided for him, and because he was such a charlatan, he was able to deceive his father, and he did it with such a level of dedication and holiness. He's so imbued with holiness that everything he did was so-called for the sake of God. With this persona and profile, he's definitely the qualified zvulun. Little did he know was he being deceived. Because he was such a charlatan, only Rivka only knew who he was, because Shem explained to her and shared with her through a divine communication who he truly was, which was impossible to know other than if God told you himself. So the difficulty is, so why Rivka shared it with him? We find Yaakov was afraid. What happens if my father curses me? When she wanted him to receive the bracha, what happens if he curses me? make, let Yitzchok, your husband, be aware of what he is. She never shared it with him. Now, Yitzchok was a prophet, Avram was a prophet. When she's having this difficulty with the pregnancy, you don't think she consults with Avram, a father-in-law? You don't think she consults with her husband, Yitzchok, who was a prophet? Of course she consults him. But what does a prophet know? A prophet only knows what God tells him. Avram couldn't know who Esav was, because the reason why Avram passed away 5 years before his time was God promised him that he's going to die a ripe, good old age. If he'd be aware that his grandson is going to be this evil person, this is contrary to the promise. So Avram says, I don't know. He goes to Yitzchok. She goes to Yitzchok, says, I don't know. Because again, the whole story of the birthright, the brochos, the b'choro, that Yaakov had taken it, and which enraged Esav, this was the basis, but Esav saw it in Yaakov. That had to have come about. So therefore Yitzchok had to remain in the dark. Couldn't know about it. This is the reason. She couldn't share it. But the way, because he was that level of charlatan, and he deceived his father said, this proves he is the appropriate zvula. Kitzayim b'fi, he provided as a provider. It's interesting. The Chazal tells us, and Yisachar, the zvula was so dedicated to Yisachar, he did not want Yisachar to waste a moment of his Torah, he would put the food into his mouth. You know, he would cut the food on the plate that Yisachar didn't have to interrupt his Torah study, not for a moment. It was ready for immediate consumption. That's what kind of provider his zvula was for Yisachar. Kitzayim b'fiv was the equivalent of what? Of his zvula's relation with Yisachar. That's why Vayev is Esav. That's why he loved him. Because without him, you can't have a Yisachar. Has nothing to do with his desire for meat whatsoever. They were about to be born. Esau comes out first. Yaakov's holding on to the heel of Esau. That's what he's called. Yaakov, the word, okay. Yaakov wanted to be out first. Why? Because he wanted to be the Mechor. I mean, ultimately, he had the Mechor. But if he would naturally come out first, the whole strife and tension between Yaakov and Esau would have never been, because Esau would have never been considered to be the firstborn, to have the birthright. Zakarish Baruch Hu, and especially Rashi cites Chazal that factually Yaakov was conceived first, because they weren't identical twins. So Yaakov should have come out first. And they fought, because Yaakov knew what was at stake, that all the suffering till the end of time comes through Edom. We're under his heel continuously. If we should fail, we're under his heel. That's our Ruhi Malchus, the 10 martyrs, who were they killed by the Romans, who destroyed the second Beis HaMikdash, the Romans. This is all Esav Sof Eliyakov. The Jews suffering throughout history, outside of the Arabs, who are they? They were all what? To this degree, they were Romans. This is Edom,